This morning we're going to consider Jesus' entry into Jerusalem on what is traditionally known as Palm Sunday. So we're going to look at two passages to begin with. If you would turn to Mark chapter 11, and at the same time, or shortly thereafter, turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 2. And we're going to look at those two passages as a jump-off point and kind of as a springboard to some ideas here that we're going to consider. So Mark chapter 11, and then 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Let me read. I'll start in Mark chapter 11, verses 1 through 11. Now when they came near Jerusalem to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, he sent out two of his disciples, and he said to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and as soon as you have entered it, you will find a colt tied on which no one has sat. Loose it and bring it. And if anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord has need of it,' and immediately he will send it here." So they went their way and found the colt tied by the door outside on the street, and they loosed it. And some of those who stood there and said to them, "What are you doing loosing the colt?" So they spoke to them just as Jesus had commanded, and they let them go. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their garments on it, and he sat on it. And many spread their garments on the road, and others cut down leafy branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Then those who went before and those who followed cried out, saying, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And Jesus went into Jerusalem and into the temple. So when he had looked around at all the things, as the hour was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. And then if you turn over to 2 Corinthians chapter 2. And verse 14. Now thanks be to God, who always leads us in triumph in Christ, and through us diffuses the fragrance of his knowledge in every place. For we are to God the fragrance of Christ among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing. To the one we are the aroma of death to death, and the other of life to life. And who is sufficient for these things? I'd like to pray and we'll begin. Lord, your word has declared to us in, hundreds of places that you love people, Lord. And that you so loved the world that you sent your Son, Father, to pay for our sins. And you are so motivated by love. And it's just, it's the essence of who and what you are. Among other things, you're holy and you're just and you're good. But Lord, you're also love. And your desire, Lord, is for each one of us to be healed, to be saved first and foremost, and to be healed, to be touched, to be led, to be guided, to have the confusion of life unscrambled. Lord, you've made us to be your vessels. You've gifted us. You've put passions within us, and you've given us abilities to serve you and to bless people, God. And Lord, you so want to see us be everything you created us to be, and to be entangled from the insanity that's on the earth, Lord. And so we thank you so much, God, for your heart for us. I thank you for your heart for me and for my wife and my children and my grandchildren and my friends. Thank you for your heart for us, Lord. May we realize that you've come to give us life and that more abundantly. May we receive it, Lord, on your terms, God, not on ours. So do a good work here today, Lord. Thank you. We pray in your name, Jesus. Thank you. Amen. For me, Palm Sunday is all about Jesus being very intentional in his entrance into Jerusalem. He did it in such a way that it would be unmistakable to those who would notice the clues or notice the prophecies and understand what was happening. He did it in a very intentional way. And he did it in a very intentional way so that he would be recognized, so that he would be received. Jesus came to be received. His desire is to be received and to be embraced and to be trusted. Jesus wants you to trust him with your life today and with your dreams and your hopes and your fears and your disappointments and your sorrows and regrets. Everything that excites you and everything that causes you shame and everything that causes you fear, Jesus wants you to throw it all on him, and he wants to care for you and love you. And so he entered into this world, and you know, of course, we know the Christmas story. He came as a child and born of a virgin. But he grew as a man, and he grew as a man full of the Holy Spirit. And then he presented himself to the Jewish people in Jerusalem in a way that was really clear for them to understand. And the great sorrow in regards to Palm Sunday is that they wanted less than he wanted to give them. They had a situation, they had a problem, whereas they were occupied by Rome. You know, the Roman armies were dominating them, and they wanted liberation. But the only liberation that they wanted was that which was temporal. They didn't want it on the inside, they wanted it on the outside. In essence, if I could paraphrase, they said, Jesus, we have diagnosed ourselves, we know what the problem is, and we just need you to make our problem go away. And they radically missed that he came to heal their lives, not just to solve their problems. And so what I want to share with you today is that Jesus came very deliberately, not to be your problem solver, but to be your savior, and to be your healer, to be the lover of your soul, to be the companion that's closer than a friend, to pour out his spirit in you, to take care of every inner need that you have as a human being. And where we fall short, and we all fall short, and I fall short too, where we all fall short is this, that we have a big problem here and maybe a big problem there, and we think that Jesus just came to just take care of those things that we can recognize, when he came to just do this holistic healing and salvation work on every part of what is you. So as we're here, you know, as considering these words today, I want you to be thinking, how has Jesus come to you? How has Jesus manifested himself to you? You know, I see the faces here, and most of you I know are followers of Jesus already. So at some point in your life, you recognized him calling to you, and you said yes on some level. But it doesn't end there, because he didn't just come to save you from the judgment of God. He came to make your life complete and whole. And sometimes we just want him to deal with the parts that we recognize. For others of us, some of you here might have never said yes to Jesus. And another thing that happens here at church, and just I'm giving you a bit of a preview, because if I kind of explain things ahead of time, then the sermon teaches itself, right? You know, I experience people that come to church and they come in a crisis. You know, grandma's sick, or my marriage is on the rocks, or I have this terrible addiction, or I like this girl, or I like this guy, and they came and brought me here, and if I can just kind of hang out with church, then maybe I'll get them too. And people come with a crisis or a desire, and they think that's the key issue, and add a little bit of Jesus to the mix, and then, but when grandma doesn't get better, they're gone. Or when the marriage doesn't get better, they're gone. Or when this person doesn't like them, they're gone. And to them, Jesus is just an additive. He's just a problem solver. But guys, he's so much more than that, isn't he? Amen? He's everything. He came to be everything, and he came to do everything. Everything that you as a human being need to have done, every bit of healing, every bit of saving, every bit of changing, he came to do that. So he came to them very deliberately, very purposefully, very in a very observable fashion. But he's also coming to you in a very observable fashion. He'll come to you today through his word. But he's come to you today through people. other pastors, other teachers, loved ones, friends, relatives, people that you know, people that are gone and you miss. He's come to you through them. He comes to you through the still small voice in your own heart, speaking to you, inviting you to trust him, inviting you to follow him, inviting you to have faith. He comes to you. But don't limit what he wants to do. I think we shy away from the word holistic because we think it sounds too new agey or something and that you have to give up red meat or something. I don't know, but the holistic idea is like he came, holistic is just like the whole person. If you're sick today, let us pray for you. If you're afraid today, let us pray for you. Or maybe not, maybe you're even too afraid to come down and get prayer. Cry out to Jesus. He came to touch the whole you. And he's coming to you, and he comes again and again and again. So let's read now and consider how he came to them. But because they had it figured out ahead of time what he ought to look like, they missed it. So none of us miss him today. In your notes, I'd like to quote from David Gusick, a favorite pastor, teacher of mine. He says, "We call the event the triumphal entry, this Palm Sunday entrance into Jerusalem, but it was a strange kind of triumph. If you spoke of Jesus' triumphal entry to a Roman, they would have laughed you in the face. For them, a triumphal entry was a great honor granted to a Roman general who won a complete and decisive victory and had killed at least 5,000 enemy soldiers. When the general returned to Rome, they had an elaborate parade, first the treasures captured from the enemy, then the prisoners, his armies marched unit by unit, and finally the general rode in a golden chariot pulled by magnificent horses. Priests burned incense in his honor." That was the reference to 2 Corinthians. "To some we are the fragrance." When a Roman general came back into town, there was a parade, there was the soldiers and all of that, and there was the captured prisoners and the booty that they had captured, you know, the goods from the other army. But the priests burned incense to their gods. And so as people lined up on the street, they didn't just see things, they had a sense of, wow, they smelled it. To them, it was the smell of victory. To the prisoners marching at the end of the parade, it was the smell of death. But there was much more than just a visual thing. There was a sense of the presence of something great that had happened. David Gusick is telling us that the Romans would have considered the triumphal entry of Jesus a joke because they measured things with a different standard. Continuing on, "First came the treasures captured from the enemy, then the prisoners. His armies marched unit by unit, and finally the general rode in a golden chariot pulled by magnificent horses. Priests burned incense in his honor, and the crowd shouted his name and praised him. The procession ended at the arena, where some of the prisoners were thrown to wild animals for the entertainment of the crowd. That was a triumphal entry, not a Galilean peasant sitting on a few coats set out on a pony." And so by human standards, the triumphal entry of Jesus was a joke. But by God's standards, it was exactly what the people who were looking for their king, for their savior, it was exactly what they needed to see because it was foretold. It would be a very identifiable event. I want us to backtrack just a little bit. We're going to look at a few verses here. As early as 6 months prior to his death, Jesus began to prepare his disciples. So if you turn back to Matthew chapter 8, and a lot of what we're going to be looking at here is in the notes. That's why we share with you, so you can kind of anticipate. And if you want to go to some places ahead of time, and we're just going to put together a string of facts here and try to get a feel for how things were, what things were like. Romans chapter 8, verse 31, "And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed and after 3 days rise again. And he spoke this word openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. And when he had turned around and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter, saying, 'Get behind me, Satan. You are not mindful of the things of God, but of the things of men.'" That's a whole another sermon. And how would you like your name recorded in history right there? "Get behind me, Bill Walden. You're thinking like a devil." It's like, oh, do you have to write it down? See, this is exactly that. We could stop there. We won't, because I have some time left and I'll use every minute I can. But, he's thinking like a man. He's not mindful of the things of God. Jesus, what good are you to overthrow Rome if you die on a cross? Don't you know, I have diagnosed our problem. We have diagnosed our problem. And this is what you're supposed to do for us. And I know you're God and everything, but we're going to tell you what to do and how to do it. And don't interrupt our plan. And so Jesus just said, you're thinking like a man. You don't have the mind of God on this thing. But Jesus was trying to prepare them. Turn over to Mark chapter 9, verse 30. He's trying to prepare them because it was such a contrary thought to what they thought should happen. As I said, they had a plan, but it wasn't God's plan. Matthew 9, verse 30. We're going to skip the other Matthew 9 passage. Verse 30, Then they departed from there and passed through Galilee, and he did not want anyone to know it. For he taught his disciples and said to them, the Son of Man is being delivered into the hands of men, and they will kill him. And after he is killed, he will rise the third day. But they did not understand this saying, and they were afraid to ask him. It was a shocking consideration. Once again, I just have to drive this point home. It was so contrary to what they thought should happen. Let's stop and make application. Do you ever find yourself in the place where you are absolutely sure what needs to happen to solve your problem? If my wife would only, if my husband would only, if my boss would only, and we fill in the blanks and we're absolutely positive that we've rightly diagnosed what God ought to do. And he comes and he's working something different, but it's not acceptable to us, and we push back. We humans haven't changed much since these days. We do the same thing. I understand that. We understand it if you're honest with yourself. At least you understand it about the people around you, but that self-revelation is coming, If you just kind of live long enough, you'll figure that out, that you think the same way as they did. So Jesus is trying to prepare them. It's too much for them. Mark chapter 10, verse 32. Now they were on the road going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was going before them, and they were amazed. Now, why were they amazed? It says in Isaiah, because he set his face like flint, which means he kind of clenched his jaw, and he's been telling them for 6 months, I'm going to go be killed. And now he's marching in that direction, and they're looking at him, and they're afraid. Because they're thinking, this is just way too intense, and they're amazed, and they're just, disconcerted. They don't know what to think or how to feel. And as they followed, they were afraid. Then he took the 12 aside again and began to tell them the things that would happen to him. And here he is telling them again, behold, we are going to Jerusalem. The Son of Man will be delivered to the chief priests and to the scribes. They will condemn him to death, deliver him to the Gentiles, and they will mock him and scourge him. You've seen The Passion, right? The movie? It's a horrible thing. And they will spit on him, and they will kill him, and on the third day he will rise again. And so he's preparing them. He's telling them this thing's going to be very deliberate. Not only is it a deliberate preparation, but it's going to be a deliberate preparation for after the fact when he's been raised from the dead. Isn't that how life is too sometimes, guys? God tells us, this is what needs to happen. This is what I'm going to do. Doesn't make sense. Still doesn't make sense. And then the day comes, you go, oh, now I get it. Now I understand what you were talking about. And in that in-between time, we feel like we're in no man's land. The dots are not connecting. We don't understand. We're confused. We wonder if we've thought about the wrong thing. It's just a confusing time. When they finally got it and saw the resurrected Christ, even then it took some time. But after that settled into them, guys, they were changed men, and they changed the world, didn't they? They changed the world. Their recognition of the truth of God is why we are here today. On a human level, speaking on a human level, God used those 12 men to change the world. But going into it, it didn't make any sense, and they thought Jesus had completely misdiagnosed the problem. What is it that you think Jesus needs to do for you today? Would you be open to the fact that maybe you've misdiagnosed the problem? Would you be open to the fact that as you expect him to come here and deal with this in your life, that he might come this way and do something totally different, and that it's what you really need? Would you be open to that fact? Please just tell me yes. Okay. Do you know what you just agreed to? That's a hard thing. We can sit here and agree to it, but when it happens, it's hard. It's really hard. It's very difficult. The triumphal entry. Look at your notes. It was the plan of God to present Jesus as Messiah. This whole foreknowledge thing, he says there's going to be a man, there's going to be a colt, either arranged or simple foreknowledge. Jesus was very much in charge here. The setting was Jerusalem, the Passover feast. They were celebrating their release from slavery, 400 years of slavery. They're still celebrating it after all the years that since God the Father had released them from slavery in Egypt. There's over 2 million pilgrims in town at this time. If you want to present yourself, you know, the best time to do it, I guess, according to God's economy, is when there's a crowd. And they are there, the Jewish pilgrims are there with great anticipation. In looking back on the Passover, it was celebrating God's deliverance. And they're still in that mindset. God, what are you going to do? Here are the Romans. We're under their thumb. What are you going to do? Send your Messiah. Send your Savior. They're in obvious need. They know they're in obvious need. They know that there's obviously problems, but they're aiming too low. Because if the Romans go away, then they're just left with themselves, and then they'll just start infighting. Dear people, the problem is not external. It's us. I forget what cartoon it was. But, you know, somebody will remember, we have met the enemy and he is us. It's our hearts. It's not the situation. If you could clear out all the adverse situations of your life right now, you would find yourself just struggling with heart problems, and then add one more person to the mix and it's not multiplied by two, it's multiplied by four. It just happens. It's just the way it is. But these people here at this point are very anticipatory. Look at your notes, Luke chapter 19. As he drew near the city, he saw the city and wept over it, saying, if you had known, even you, especially in this your day, the things that make for your peace, but they are hidden from your eyes. They wanted external peace. Jesus wanted to give them internal peace. They wanted temporal peace. He wanted to give them eternal peace. And he wept because they missed it. He wept because they wanted less than he wanted to give them. Some of us know this feeling, don't we? Some of us have loved ones and friends, and they're struggling like crazy. And you're looking at them, and you're just your fists are clenched, and your heart is broken, and you're praying, and you're praying, and you're praying, and you're saying, oh, if you could just know the peace of God. Well, how can I know the peace of God when I'm going to lose my apartment? Oh, if you could just know the peace of God. God's so much bigger than your apartment. Yeah, but that stupid guy next door has a barking dog and no dogs are allowed. I'm just going to, the manager won't listen to me. And it's like, oh, if you could only know the salvation of God. You know, they're upset about something not insignificant, but less significant, right? And we yearn and we ache for people to know how good God is, don't we? Right? Amen? We yearn for that and we ache for them and we pray and we try to explain, but all they can see is this thing right here. It's all they can see. And guys, if our hearts break because we have loved ones that don't see the potential of all that God can do, they're just looking at this little thing right in front of them. And our hearts break over that. Jesus' heart broke for those people. He came over the hill, he looked at Jerusalem, and he just started weeping, saying, if you only knew what I could do for you. But you want this way down here, and I want to give you all of this way up here. And you think I should come and do these little things over, but I want to come and do all these big things up here. And because I'm not performing how you think I should perform, in 5 days you're going to turn and say, crucify him. Kill him. He didn't come through. How many times have we heard people say, I tried the Jesus thing. It didn't work. How many of us have heard people say that? Tried the Jesus thing. Tried the church thing. For 3 weeks, didn't work. My situation didn't change. That's because your problem is not your situation. Your problem is your heart. You need salvation. You need healing. You need the holistic touch of God. Yes. The unridden colt spoken of in Zechariah 9:9, very intentional. Zechariah had prophesied it hundreds of years earlier. Rejoice greatly, daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. It's like, hundreds of years in advance, save the date. You know, there's something that's going to happen here. Save the date. He is just and having salvation, low and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. Roman general would ride on a stallion. Jesus came in humility, riding on that little donkey, that unridden donkey. Look at the people's expectations and response. Turning back to Mark chapter 11. Look at verse 9. Those who went before and those who followed cried out, saying, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. They're quoting from Psalm 118. Hosanna was a Hebrew phrase that meant save now. And I've already made the case. They know they need salvation, but they just need these Roman guys to go away. And God wants to do so much more. They're quoting the part that they like from Psalm 118, and they're leaving out the part that they don't see from Psalm 118. Look at your notes. The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing. It's marvelous in our eyes. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Save now, I pray, O Lord. That's the Hosanna part. I pray, send now prosperity. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. They love the send prosperity part. We love the send now prosperity part. God, if you'll just change my husband, I'll be the happiest Christian woman in Napa County. If you could, Lord, if you just change my teenagers, can't they just go from 10 to 25? Can't they just skip 15 years and just, you know, if you could just change my, send prosperity, Lord. And God did want to prosper them, but far beyond what they wanted. But they missed this part, guys, in verse Psalm 118:22. The stone which the builders rejected has become the foundation of life. And if we don't see Jesus as the foundation of life, then we just see him as one of these other bricks in the wall. My church building is fine. I just have a little brick missing. Jesus, could you come in and just plug that hole? He's the foundation under the building. He's not just another brick in the wall, is he? He's not just a problem solver. He's the whole thing. And if we see him as any less than that, then we measure him by that. Does that make sense? Jesus, if you love me, heal my grandma. I love you. I died on a cross for your sins 2000. Well, I don't want to hear about that. Just heal my grandma because I don't know how I can live without her. I love you. I died on a cross. I don't want to know about that. Just heal. We have tunnel vision over what we dictate how God should act. Guys, the Bible says it's appointed that men die once. Except for one generation, the rapture, the generation that is raptured to heaven, we're all going to die. And yet we stand here saying, God, if you don't heal my grandma, then I don't want anything to do with you.
If you don't heal my grandma, I don't want to.
It's the mouse screaming at the eagle. even a greater disparity than that. And then we measure him because he didn't respond to our mouse command. Don't miss what Jesus wants to do in your life. They had a display of acceptance, palm branches, a sign of victory. And for the poor people to put clothing on the ground was a great day of worship and adoration. They were emotional, needy, desperate, and willing to put forth some effort. I'm not saying they didn't put forth any effort. They put forth some effort. So do the people that come here sometimes. Or talk to you about God. They put forth some effort. But once again, it's always with strings attached, and it's always with, this is how it ought to work out in their minds. The Jewish leadership protested, quoting from Luke 19. Some of the Pharisees called to him from the crowd, Teacher, rebuke your disciples. But he answered and said to them, I tell you, if these should keep silent, the stones would cry out. This was the day. So many other times they had tried to take Jesus and make him king. And he said, my hour has not yet come. My hour has not yet come. I'm glad you're excited. My hour has not yet come. In their minds, be king, drive out the Romans. No, my hour has not yet come. And this was the hour. And as we referred to earlier in Luke, even if you had known your day this day, there has been some calculations by some mathematicians that a prophecy from Daniel chapter 9 actually forecasted and prophesied the exact day, 173,800 and something days after this Daniel prophecy, the exact day when Jesus would ride in. This day, he said, this is your moment. But they missed it. Once again, I'm just going to keep kind of pounding it home. Why? Because they self-diagnosed, and their diagnosis was wrong. And they prescribed to God what he should do, and their prescription was wrong. Dear people, I mean, look at all you beautiful people here. If there is a God in heaven, most of us do believe, if there is a God in heaven, who are we to dictate how he should do anything? It's absolutely contradictory. We can't say, oh, God, you're up there, and now here's my to-do list for you. That does not compute. If there is a God in heaven, and if he loves you, and if Christ came to die for your sins, and if all of this stuff is true, we need to be saying, Lord, whatever you want to do, here I am. I'm yours. I'm going to trust you with everything. I'm going to trust you with my money, my family, my health, my career, my hobbies. I'm going to trust you with my vacation time. I'm going to trust you with my enemies. I'm going to trust you with sometimes I hate myself and I want to be self-destructive. I'm going to trust you with my addictions. I'm going to trust you with everything. We don't give him a list. We say, yes, Lord. Because if the moment you give him a list is the moment that you put yourself back in charge. And if he doesn't do things according to your timetable, then you X him out. He is the creator. We are the creation, right? And so many miss him. And is he mad about that? What have we read in Luke? No, he cries. My heart's broken over some situations as I think about them. As I stand here right now before you, I have a heavy heart over situations. So a lot of you do too. Heavy hearts over people that are struggling with life. God's heart is infinitely more burdened about humanity than mine is. Because I have a small, small scope of humanity. And with what I can see, you know, there's a lot of neat things. I've been praying and I'm rejoicing and thanking God over the way he's working in some people's lives right now. There's some really neat things happening, but there's always some stuff that's heavy and sad, right? And if I get frustrated, it's just because those people can't see him like I can or like we can. Somehow by God's grace, we have clearer vision and we have experienced his presence more. But if my heart's heavy, his heart's heavy. And if you're here not seeing him for who he is, I don't think he's, you know, crossing his arms and stomping his feet and shaking a finger in your face. I think he's just sad because he wants to do so much for you. It's just our way to minimize him, isn't it? The people had misplaced expectation, incorrect interpretation. They had wrong actions. I've talked about all of this. Turn over to Mark chapter 10, verse 35. Wrong expectations. Like I said, I've been talking about this. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him saying, Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask. Sorry, it just strikes me as ridiculous. That's exactly what we do, isn't it? It's 2,000 years ago. It's exactly what we do. God, I want you to do, I totally worship you and trust you. Now do what I say. What's wrong with that statement? It just doesn't make sense. And he said to them, what do you want me to do? Grant that we may sit on your right hand and your other on your left in your glory. Were they willing to be crucified on his right and left? They didn't want the cross. They just wanted the glory. They didn't want the thorns. They just wanted the crown. Jesus said, you don't know what you're asking. You can't even, can you drink the cup that I drink and be baptized with the baptism that I'm baptized with? And they said, oh, sure. And they said, well, you will indeed drink the cup that I drink and be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with. But to sit on my right hand left is not mine, but it's given to those for whom it's prepared. The point there is just that Jesus, I'm a Christian. I just do things my way and everything will be fine. It's just contradictory, isn't it? They didn't understand their greatest need was for forgiveness. By the end of the week, they're shouting for his execution. You can read about that in Mark chapter 15. Turn over to Mark chapter 16, if you would. Once again, we see the different expectations, the wrong expectations. It's just, you know, I hope you don't feel like I'm scolding you. I'm talking about me too. I want God. You know what? I love myself so much. You know, in the morning, I wake up and it's just, I have a mirror right there. No, I'm teasing. I wake up in the morning and it's just all about me. It's so easy, isn't it? Come on, tell the truth about yourself. Just any other egocentric people out there? It's just so easy just to think about, you know, therefore everything is filtered through the grid of Bill. Well, they should be this way and they should act that way and they should treat me this way and that person, it's like, you know, there's only room for one on the throne and it's the Lord, not me, you know? So I hope it doesn't seem like I'm scolding you. I'm making remarks about us. We all do this. We just have to change, and by God's grace, we can and do change, you know? But we can really get stuck and get ourselves in a mess. Mark chapter 16, verse 9, happened on the as he rose early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, of whom he had cast out seven demons, and she went and told those who had been with him as they mourned and wept, and when they heard that he was alive and had been seen by her, they didn't believe it. After that, he appeared in another form to two of them as they talked and went into the country, and they went and told it to the rest, but they didn't believe it either. Now, how many times had he already told them, they're going to kill me and I'm going to rise again? Remember all those other times we've been looking at that? Verse 14, afterward, he appeared to the 11 as they sat at the table, and he rebuked their unbelief and the hardness of heart because they did not believe those who had seen him after he had been risen. And then he said, go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He rebuked their unbelief and the hardness of their heart. Once again, I just have to say it. They self-diagnosed, and their diagnosis was wrong. They analyzed God, and they misanalyzed God. And we have to be aware of those things. Down at the bottom of your notes, if you want to look there with me, looking back on the triumphal entry, for a time, the disciples must have felt like the biggest fools on earth. We followed this guy. We saw him do miracles. He said he was, you know, the Messiah, and they killed him, and boy, are we idiots. And as I've already confessed, you know, feeling like they do at times, sometimes I feel like an idiot. Sometimes following Jesus is absolutely every bit about faith and none of it about understanding or feeling. Anybody else recognize that? It's just like, I know your word says that you're going to work out all things together for my good, but I don't see it. I don't understand it. I don't know how you could ever do this. And people are looking, just going, what an idiot. And I go, I know I'm an idiot. And they must have felt just like the most foolish men on the face of the earth. They gave up everything to follow him. They had cast out demons, healed the sick. They'd seen miracles. They heard the best teaching mankind has ever heard. And then he was killed. And they were distraught, and they just thought, oh, it's just, once again, why? Because they misdiagnosed themselves, and they wrongly analyzed God. It's just easy to do. My final little notes here. How do you look back on the triumphal entry? The Romans said it was foolishness. The Jews saw it was misplaced hope. Or do you look back on it as a Christian? Do you look back and say, yeah, that was my Savior. He came into town that day, and about 5 days later, he died for my sins, and then he was raised from the dead after that. Do you look back on it like that? But not just on a historical level, guys, I want to ask you, how do you look right now in your own life about God entering into your life right now? Have you prescribed to the Lord how he is allowed to work in your life and how you think his arrival ought to look like? Because you've mapped out, you know, you have your one-year plan and your three-year plan and your five-year plan and so on and so forth, and you've got everything figured out. And yes, you're a Christian, and you know you've done some wrong stuff and you needed forgiveness, but, you know, Jesus, this is your compartment over here. I got my career, I have my plans, and I have my family. I got my hobbies over here, and I'm trying to be frugal, and I'm coaching Little League and teaching, you know, our daughter how to cook and stuff, and we're doing all these things, and Jesus, kind of just stay right there, and I'm managing everything. And he's like, don't put me in the closet. I'm the foundation, I'm the walls, I'm the roof, I'm everything. I'm the inside of the house, I'm the outside of the house. And if you keep him over here, guys, when your son over here breaks his femur on the soccer field, you're going to say, God, how could you do this? Well, because you just thought I was over here to kind of give you a good, warm, fuzzy feeling. You never trusted me with your kid. Over here, God, how could you let my boss believe that lie about me and now my job is at risk? Well, you've been keeping me nice and comfy over here on this little three-legged stool, but I'm everything. And if you just want him to be compartmentalized Jesus, I don't think he's going to stand for it. Because he's not. He's not going to force himself into your life. But if you compartmentalize him and keep him on a leash, if you're going to do that, then don't blame him when things go wrong, right? Right? Does that make sense? If he's just kind of an addition to your life, then don't blame him when you think he should have been watching out for your kid, because you just have him over here on a leash. But guys, if we, and that's the downside, and I hope I don't mean to scold, but what I do mean to say is this, if he's everything, and you trust him with everything, and if you surrender and say, God, you know best, then our eyes aren't closed to what he wants to do. Then you'll say, as hard as that broken leg was, as hard as that financial setback was, as hard as losing a friend, as hard as giving up my dream was, God, you work all things together for my good, and I love you, and I praise you, and I trust you. And isn't that how we want to live? Amen, anybody? That's how we want to live. These guys were, if I may say this, I'm going to get my little thing over here. I think these guys were more distraught. I'm just venturing a guess here. These guys were more distraught than you've ever been. Because they walked away from their homes and their jobs and their families and their careers and everything to follow him. See, they put a lot more on the line than probably most of us do. I don't mean to minimize what you're putting on the line. They put everything on the line. When you put everything on the line, the corresponding disagreement or disappointment is greater. But only if you have prescribed how Jesus ought to act and live and be God. But if we take our hands off and say, Lord, be the God of my life. And I don't know if you're going to come to me from that grandma over there or from that kindergartner over there. And I don't know if you're going to come at me through Pastor Bill or through somebody out in the courtyard. Or I don't know if you're going to come to me through a blessing, what I would consider a blessing, or a trial. I don't know how you're going to come to me, but I trust you. Because you have the things that make for my peace. And not peace as is described, absence of conflict, but peace in the middle of conflict. Make sense? Peace isn't the absence of conflict. The peace that God wants to give us passes all understanding. It's right in the midst of conflict. It's life. Okay, so where are we at? Don't believe that you think you know the solution to every one of your problems, and don't think that you can prescribe to God how he ought to work in your life, and don't compartmentalize him, and don't tell him how he can enter in and lead you. You know, we sing that song here, I'll stand with arms high and hearts abandoned in awe of the one who made it all. Lift up your hands to the Lord, surrender to God. He came in an obvious way that they could understand. He comes to you in an obvious way. If you'll have eyes to hear, eyes to see, ears to hear, a heart to perceive, if you don't prescribe ahead of time how you should do things and watch God do amazing things in your life. Do we have any questions this morning, guys? No questions. Let's stand together. Noah, kind of unprepared here. Can you lead us in a song? Would you bow your heads with me in your hearts? And I'm just going to kind of pray for myself, and if it applies to you, you can agree, and if not, you can pray yourself. Lord, I'm sorry that I have dictated to you what my life should look like, and I'm sorry that I have relied on my feelings so much and my limited understanding. And Lord, I love it when you come and do your great things in my life, and I'm so thankful, Lord, that you are gracious to me. And you let me flail, and you let me whine, and you let me complain, and you give grace to my wife to listen to me complain, and you still come through. And somehow you work in me, and somehow you work in us if we will trust you. And Lord, we never regret believing you. Lord, would you keep us from limiting you. May we believe, may I believe, God, that you know exactly what needs to happen in my life, and may I surrender, may we surrender. And our Father, we pray for any here today that just think they need a little bit of you, Lord. They need all of you, and you want all of them. And so may they find a way to surrender their lives to you. Thank you, Lord. Let's sing to the Lord together.
Compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. My Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me. All my fears and failures, come fill my life again. Give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender, I surrender, yeah. My Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. My Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. My Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Yeah. I want to invite you guys to respond to the Lord right now, just where you're standing with our heads bowed. The people in Jerusalem knew that they were needy, and they asked for salvation, but they had it in their mind what that looked like. And I just want to invite any of you today that you know you're needy, and maybe you're afraid, and maybe you know your needs, and it seems bigger than you, and you're pretty sure that you can't solve it. But I want to invite you, if you know you're needy, would you add something to that? And if you want to lift your hand when I say this, just say, Lord, I'm needy, but I don't want to tell you how to do it. And if you'd like to lift your hand to the Lord and just say, Lord, I don't know how to do it, but I want to surrender this need to you. And I don't want to overthink it, and I don't want to overanalyze it. I want to seek you, and I want to know you, and I want to watch your deliverance arrive in a way I never would have expected. So Lord, help us to not overanalyze and to not determine your path of action, but Lord, to lift our hands in praise and to trust that you know best. Thank you, Lord. We so look forward to this week as we consider, God, the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. Thank you, Lord. We love you. Thank you that you love us, Lord. We pray in your name. Amen.